वेलकम टू वी लर्न्स ऑनलाइन क्लास। वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट द सेशन अबाउट डेटाबेस मैनेजमेंट सिस्टम एंड इन टुडे सेशन वी विल डू द इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ डेटाबेस मैनेजमेंट सिस्टम। इन दिस सेशन वी विल कवर द आर्किटेक्चर ऑफ डेटाबेस, मीनिंग ऑफ डेटाबेस, फाइल बेस्ड सिस्टम, लिमिटेशंस ऑफ फाइल बेस्ड सिस्टम and the different levels of architecture of database management system. Now, first of all, what is database? Database is an organized collection of data, or you can say when you present data in a structured manner or when you organize data in a structured manner, then it can be treated as database. And database management system is responsible for managing the database of entire enterprise. Means database management system are some software packages with the help of which you can construct the data, you can define the database, and you can perform any manipulation functions of the on the database. Now, as I told you, database is an organized collection of data, or you can say structured representation of data. Now, what is data? Data means raw facts and figures, or you can see the facts that can be recorded and have some implicit meaning is known as data. Now, you know what is database and what is data. Next term is what is database management system. As I already told you earlier, that it is a software package, or you can say system, with the help of which you can define the database, you can construct the database, and you can perform any manipulation function of the on the databases. Next is file based system. Before DBMS, or you can say before database management systems, file based systems were used. Now, what is the difference between file based system and database system? And you can say why there is a need of database management system. Firstly, when we use file based system or in manual file based system, there are different number of files which have to be maintained. For example, if we take an example of an organization in which three departments are there. One is purchase department, second is sales department, and third one is stock department. Each department maintains a list of their items or the list of their records. For example, if we talk about purchase department, then purchase department will store the information about the products. You can say product ID, product name, and total quantity. And after total quantity, the quantity purchased and the rate of purchase. So in this a product, or you can say purchase department maintain a file in which product ID is there, product name is there, quantity, total quantity is there, and product purchase quantity and purchase rate is there. Similarly, sales department maintain its own file which contains the product ID, similarly product name, total quantity, sales quantity or sale price. Similarly, the stock department will maintain its own file which will contain the information about the stock. The information may be the product description, that is product ID, product name, and the total quantity of product. In this way, you can see in the file-based system in which each department maintain its own file, there is a duplicacy of records. First drawback of the file management system, because the product ID, name and quantity, these three fields are used by three departments in different places. And in file based system, if these three fields are maintained separately, then there is a result of it causes duplicacy. Secondly, due to duplicacy, inconsistency is there. For example, sale department sell 10 unit of any product, it deduct the quantity by 10, but if in case purchase department omits to deduct the total quantity by 10, or the stock department omits to deduct the total quantity by 10, then there will be inconsistency between the data shown in sales table or shown in purchase and stock table. So there is drawbacks in file based system, because of which there is a need of database management system. Some of the drawbacks I have discussed with you, like duplicacy, inconsistency of data present at various departments or present at various locations. Now, what are the limitations? You can see here, separation and isolation of data. As I told you earlier, there is a separation of data, duplication of data, data is duplicated at various places, inconsistency of data, data dependency between different departments, and incompatible file formats. There may be a chance where the formats of files are incompatible with one another, and fixed queries. There are the number of queries that can be performed or number of operations that can be performed in file-based systems are very limited, and these are the total limitations of file-based systems, which are removed in database management system. Next is database approach. Due to the various drawbacks of file management system, the database approach is used, and database is a structured collection of related data, and the initial attempts were to provide the centralized collection of data. Database is a self-describing nature, and it contains not only the data but also the complete definition of database structures and constraints. Now, what are the advantages of database approach? It reduces the redundancies. It facilitates the sharing of data into various departments. So you can say the data can be shared at various locations. Data independence is there because the data stored in database, and the database's data. In case of databases data, the dependency is removed. It improves the integrity of data. You can easily access the data, and multiple user interface can be provided in case of database approach. As I give you example of an organization in which sales, purchase and stock department are there. If we create a database which contains the product ID, product name, quantity, purchase quantity, then sales quantity, then purchase rate and sales rate. If we maintain all this data under one database, then the benefit of this database approach is there is a centralized location of database, and each user, if there are multiple users and if they have different requirements, then the users can access the data, users can retrieve the data from the database as per their requirement efficiently and easily as compared to file-based system, and there will be no redundancies or you can say duplicacy in case of database approach. In this way, database approach is very useful approach for storing the database in a centralized manner. Next is architecture of database. Now, the database architecture is divided into majorly three components, that is internal architecture, conceptual architecture and external architecture. External architecture is closest to the user, which provides the interface, functional application interfaces and views through which the user interacts with the database. At conceptual level, the objects and relations between objects are described, and at the internal level is closest to the physical device, or you can say the data structures, files, records, the physical devices are related to the internal logical DBMS architecture. Means there are total three architect three levels of architecture, that is external, conceptual and internal. External, which are closest to the user, internal, which are closest to the device, and conceptual, in which the database is conceptually defined or conceptually designed. As you see here, the conceptual level presents the logical view of the entire database as the unified whole, and external and view level is the highest level of abstraction, which allows the user to see only the data of interest to them. For example, if you want to perform any transaction at the bank or at ATM, then the interfaces through which the user interact with that particular transaction or that particular software is of external level, by which the user interact with the particular database. Conceptual level means which present the logical view of entire database. Logical view means data types, sizes, these are the logical views. And internal or physical level means the collection of files permanently stored on the secondary storage device. So you can say the physical database, or the internal level is also known as the physical level, at which the database is closest to the, or this level is closest to the physical devices on which the data is stored. Now, if we talk about the mapping between levels and data independence, that there are two types of mappings. First is conceptual or internal mapping, and second is external or conceptual mapping. Now, if we talk about the data independence, firstly, we will talk about the needs of three-level architecture, the objective of the three-level architecture, or the objective of dividing the architecture of database into three levels is to separate each user's view of the database from the way the database is physically represented. Means to facilitate the user and to facilitate the separate user's view of the database from the way the database is physically represented. Now, it helps in support for multiple users' view, and it provides an insulation between the user programs and data that does not concern them. This is the physical DBMS architecture. Earlier we discussed about the logical architecture. Now this one is the physical architecture. If we talk about the physical architecture, then end user is there. DDL, that is data definition language, through which the data can be defined or the database can be defined, then applications through which the user interacts. Then DML, compiler, query optimizer, and store data manager is there at conceptual level, and internal level data files, compile DML, and data dictionary is there. Now, what are the uses of these different components? Now, first is DML pre-compiler. DML is data manipulation language, through which we can modify the data present in the database, we can process the data to create the user's definable output. And the DML statements can also be written in the application program. Next is DDL compiler. DDL is data definition language, through which we can define the database, or through which you can create the database, or you can create a set of tables containing the metadata tables. Next is file manager. The work of file manager is to manage the allocation of space on the disk storage. There can be various files, and to allocate the space on the disk storage to different files is the work of file manager. Next is database manager. It is a program module and is basically responsible for interfacing the database file to the user's query. The main tasks of database manager are interaction with the file manager to check the integrity, to check the security, to perform backup and recovery operation, backup to create a copy of the database, and recovery if in case if any case the data is lost, then you can recover the data from the backup copy. And concurrency control means if there are more than one user available at a time on a particular database, then to control the concurrency. And in the case where multiple users wants to access the same data, then database manager is responsible. Now, there are different components of database manager. The different components are, first is authorization control. Authorization control means to check the authorization of the user, to perform the required function. Next is command processor. Now, once the system has checked whether the user has authority to perform any operation, then control is passed to the command processor, which converts the command to the logical sequence of steps to be executed next. Next is integrity checker. The work of integrity checkers checks that the requested operation satisfy all the integrity constraints, such as key constraint. Means if you want to create a table, if you want to define a database, whether it follows or whether the particular operation satisfy all the integrity constraints or not. Next is query optimizer. This module determines the optimal strategy for the query execution, whether the query execution is optimally performed or not. Next is transaction manager. The work of transaction manager is to process the transactions, process the various operations of different transactions. Scheduler is responsible for scheduling the different tasks without conflicting different tasks with one another. Recovery manager, the role of recovery manager is to recover the data in case of any failures. And buffer manager is responsible for transferring of data between the main memory and secondary storage devices. Next is database administrator. Now, database administrator can be an individual or group of persons which perform various operations or which are responsible for the different operation or different functions on a particular database. Some of the basic responsibilities of database administrator are schema definition. It means the structure of the data. The storage structure and access method definition means how you can access the data, means the ways to access the data from a database. Then the physical organization modification of the database. Granting the authority for the data access. Granting the authority means whether a particular user has read access or modification access on a particular data, or to check the integrity constraint specification of a particular database is the responsibility of database administrator. Next is data files, indices and data dictionary. The data is stored in the data files and the indices are stored in the index file. Now, what is the use of indices? Indices or the use of index file is to provide faster access to data items, because in index files, the data is organized in a particular order. And if data is organized in a particular way or is organized in a particular order, then it is very easy to fastly access the data from the index file. And next is data dictionary. What is data dictionary? Data dictionary means a dictionary which stores information about data, or you can say structure of database, means which contains data about data, or you can say metadata is known as data dictionary. And efficient dictionary, or you can say an ideal dictionary, should include everything that a DBA wants to know about the database. For example, the internal conceptual and internal database descriptions should be included in the data dictionary, and description of various entities, various records, various fields available in the database should be stored in the data dictionary. If we use any synonyms and security codes and authorization check, then it should be stored in data dictionary. And which external schemas are used by which programs and who the users are and what their authorizations are also stored in the data dictionary. And beyond this, a data dictionary also stored the statistics about the database and its users, including number of records, etc. Means all the statistics information about a database and its usage are also stored in the data dictionary. Next is commercial database architecture. Till now we discussed about two architecture, that is logical architecture and physical architecture. In logical architecture, database is divided into three categories, that is internal, external and conceptual. And in physical, there are various levels of the database. But in commercial database architecture, the most common application utilities used with a database can be divided into different categories. For example, command line interfaces, GUI tools, backup and restore utilities, which provides the facilities for backup and restoring of data, load and unload utilities, and reporting utilities, or you can say analysis utilities, to analyze the working of the database in efficient manner. Now, the most important topic is data models. Data models means how you can represent the data in different forms or in different ways. There are major three categories of data models. First is object-based model. Second is record-based model. And third one is hierarchical data representation model. First is object-based model. Object-based model is further divided into two categories, that is entity relationship model and object-oriented model. Now, what is the use of these object-oriented, or you can say object-based model? Object-based model are used to define or are used to express the real world objects and the relationship between these objects in object-oriented manner. There are two object-based models. First is entity relationship model, in which various entities and the relationship between that entities are represented in graphical form or in some symbolic forms. These are known as entity relationship models, in which different entities and relationship among different entities are shown or are described by using the graphical notations. And now, what is entity? Entity can be any object which have some attributes which uniquely identify that particular entity. Next is object-oriented model. Now, what is object-oriented model? Which defines a database as a collection of objects and objects that contain both the data members and values and operations on a particular object. Means which is a collection of objects as well as the attributes and the operations that can be performed on that data of particular object. And object models are basically useful for the database where the data interrelationship are complex. For example, if we talk about the computer assisted design based components, then there is very complex interrelationship between the different components of this computer assisted design. Then in this case we can use computer based models, object based models. Next is record based logical models. The record based logical models can be categorized into three categories, that is relational model, network model and hierarchical model. Now, what is relational model? In which the data is presented as a collection of rows and columns. Means in which data is presented in the form of relations, or you can say in the data is represented in the form of or by the collection of rows and columns. Next is network model. Network model is where the data is represented as record and the relationship is represented by the links between that particular records. Hierarchical model. Hierarchical model is used to describe the data or is used to describe the database architecture or used to model the data which is of hierarchical nature. For example, grandparents, then parents, then child, or you can say top management, middle management, lower level management. Then these are the hierarchical data of a particular organization. And to show the hierarchical type of data, hierarchical model can be used or network model can be used. But the difference between network and hierarchical model is that in hierarchical, one to many relationship is shown. As you see, there is one node and there is more than one child. That is, one to many relationship exists. Again, there is one node and many childs. Then one to many relationship exists in hierarchical model. But in network model, it also support many to many relationship as compared to hierarchical model. This is all about the database, architecture of database. Architecture can be logical architecture or physical architecture. Then different file systems which are earlier used and the advantages of database. And different data models used in the database. If you have any doubts and any queries, then you can ask about these particular topics. Now the next topic is relational and ER models. And in relational and ER models, we will discuss about the different components of relational model, that is domains, attributes, tuple, relations, keys, then relational constraints like domain constraint, key constraint, integrity constraints, then relational algebra like basic set operation, Cartesian product, and relational operation, and ER models, that is entity relationship models. Now first of all, what is relation? Relation is a table, or you can say relation is a collection of rows and columns. These are the rows, or you can say record, which contains multiple fields, that is A101, branch name downtown, and balance 500. The combination of these three fields in a particular record can be known as tuple, or it can be known as record, or it can be known as row. Vertically, if we consider, it is column, or you can say it is a field. It is an attribute of a particular table, that is account number, branch name, and balance. These are the three attributes of this particular relation, and these three attributes have different values associated in it. Now, attribute types. Each attribute of a relation has a name. For example, if we talk about this attribute, then it has a name, account number. If we talk about this attribute, then it has branch, it is named with branch name, and this third one attribute is balance. Set of allowed values for each attribute is called domain of that value. Means, in this attribute, the values that we can enter, means the allowed values and the range of values from which we can pick the value to enter in this attribute, can be known as or can be called as domain of that particular attribute. And the attribute values are required to be atomic. That means, for example, the value of attribute can be account number, but cannot be sets of account number, means which cannot be break down into different units. Then the special value null is a member of every domain. In every domain, there is a special value, that is null value, which could be there in every domain. Next is relational schema. Schema refers to the structure of the relation, and if we talk about the schema of a relation, the schema of relation includes the attribute definition, that is the name and type of the attribute. For example, if we talk about this attribute, then the name is account number and the type is text. Text means which contain alphabets as well as number and as well as special symbol called hyphen. If we talk about second attribute, then the name of the second attribute is branch name, which contains the information on in text only. And the third attribute has balance, is known as balance in this table, and the type of attribute is numbers. Then integrity constant. The second part of schema is integrity constant, means different checks or different constants that you can apply on a particular relational schema or particular relational structure. Next is relation instance. The current values of a relation are specified by a table. The current values are also known as the relation instance of a relation, and they are specified by a table. Now, these are the field name, or you can say attribute name. These four are tuples, or you can say rows, or you can say records of the particular relation. Now, if we talk about the database consists of multiple relations, and information about an enterprise is broken up into different parts with each relation storing one part of the information. For example, if we talk about accounts department, then it will use information about accounts. If we talk about depositor, then it which customer owns which account. And if we talk about customer, then the customer should be have information about the other customers. Next is keys. If we create a table, for example, in this diagram, we create a table and there are total three fields in this table. Now, there are different type of key fields or different type of keys available in a table. Or you can say there are different types of keys to identify different parts of the table. Of keys, for example, if we take different types of keys, then there can be primary key, there can be candidate key, there can be composite key, there can be secondary key, and there can be alternate key. Firstly, we will discuss about the primary key. What is primary key? Primary key is a unique identifier through which you can easily identify any of the record of the relation or of a table. Now, if we want to take example of a primary key, then we can take roll number as a primary key. Because roll number cannot contain duplicate value, or the two students doesn't have the same roll number, means the roll number can serve as a unique identifier, so it is known as primary key. But there must be some conditions for the primary key, that the primary key could not contain null values, the primary key could not be duplicate, and the primary key should be unique identifier for the particular table or particular relation. Now, next is candidate key. Now, what is candidate key? Candidate means all the keys which can serve as primary key can be known as candidate key. For example, if we have students table, and in that database we have student's roll number, student name, student contact number, address, and so on. Then roll number is a unique identifier, and contact number can also be unique of every student. Then we can make roll number as well as contact number of a student as a primary key. Means these two are the candidates that can become a primary key. But from these two fields, one is selected. For example, roll number is selected as primary key, and the remaining, that is contact number, is alternate key, which can be an alternative of a primary key. Next is composite key. Now, what is composite key? When we doesn't have a single field which can serve as a primary key, then two or more fields are joined to create a primary key or to create a key field. Then this is known as composite key, means when two or more fields are combined to form a particular key field, composite key is used. Now primary key is done, candidate key is done, composite key is done, and alternative key is done. Next is secondary key. Now see, from students table we create roll number as a primary key, contact number is an alternative of the primary key, means it is a candidate key which is alternative of roll number key, which can be an alternative of primary key, and the remaining is name and address. These are the secondary keys, means which are not primary keys. Next is foreign key. Now what is foreign key? The primary key of one table becomes the foreign key of another table if we join two tables on the basis of a particular key field. For example, if we have two tables such as employee table and department table. Employee table has employee ID, employee name, and salary. Means employee table has total three fields, that is employee ID, employee name, and salary. And department table contains department ID, department name, designation, and to link these tables, employee ID is here. Means on the basis of employee ID is the primary key of EMP table, and it becomes a foreign key of department table. If we have employee table, and employee table we have employee ID, employee name, and salary, and if we have one more table, that is department table, and if it has department ID, department name, designation, and employee ID. Means these are two different tables, that is employee table and department table. Here the employee ID is primary key. In department table, the department ID is the primary key of department table. Now, the primary key of employee table becomes the foreign key of another table. And on the basis of the foreign key, we link the two tables, that is employee table and department table. And the relational schema may have an attribute that corresponds to the primary key of another relation, as I told you, and the attribute is called a foreign key. For example, customer name and account number, attribute of depositor, are foreign keys to customer and account respectively. Next is relational constraints.
First is domain constant, second is key constant, and third one is integrity constant. Now, what is domain constant? Domain constant, according to domain constant, the foreign key can hold the values or can store the values or can take the values from the domain of its constant, from the domain of its particular table. Jaise ki, for example, if we take two tables, that is employee table and department table, the department table contains the foreign key which joins the employee table and department table. Then the foreign key of employee table, it means the foreign key, that is EMP ID, can store the values or can take the values from the EMP ID of employee table. Means if the employee ID of employee table contains the values from 1 to 10, then the department table employee ID will also contain the values from 1 to 10 only. Means it cannot take any other value from the domain of its value, because the domain of primary key is the total values available in the primary key of other table. Next is key constant, which tells that each primary key or a primary key of the table cannot contain null value, or the primary key cannot be null, or the values of the primary key cannot store null values or zero values, or they cannot except the duplicate values. This is all about the keys of the database. Now the next topic is fundamental operation in relational algebra. Some of the fundamental operations of relational algebra are selection, projection, union, set difference, Cartesian product and join. These are the fundamental operations of the relational algebra. First is selection, and select operator is sigma symbol, and it is used to select the tuples that meet this particular condition. Means it is required to check the particular condition and retrieve the records according to that particular condition. The syntax for using the selection is sigma, then selection condition, and R is here the relation name. Next is projection. Projection is used to select the particular set of attribute. In selection, we use a selection operator, or you can say select operator, to choose a particular rows and to choose a particular column. Projection operation is used, and for projection operation the symbol of pi is used to choose the attribute from a relation. Here there is a table, that person, which contains ID, name and address and hobby. If you want to select only the name and hobby, then the command will be name pi name comma hobby, because pi symbol, or you can say projection symbol, is used to select particular columns. That is, we have to specify the name of the column, that is name and hobby, and from which table you want to access these columns are person table. Similarly, if we want to apply conditions in this, then the condition can be specified by select operation, that is select hobby equals to stem from person. Means where the hobby value equals to stem, that is first record, will be selected from the person table. Next is union. Union is denoted by the symbol U, and it includes all the tuples that are in R or in S, eliminating the duplicate values. For example, in this table R and this table S, there are total 9 values, and these values will be
if we find out the union of R and S, then all the values will be in new table, that is R, R union S. But if any variable occurs two times, then it is eliminated in case of union operation. Next is set difference operation. Set difference is also known as the minus operation, which includes only the tuple of one relation that are not present in the other relation, and it is denoted by the minus symbol. For example, if you want to find out the S difference R, it will present all the values of S which are not present, all the values of R which are not present in the S. For example, A is present in S, then it is eliminated. B is eliminated. A will be covered in R difference S because A is present in this table but is not present in table S. Similarly, D is present in both the tables. Then F is present in table R but not in S, so F is considered. Then E is present in both the tables. Then E is not considered. This is wrong. E will not be considered. Next is S difference R. If you want to perform the S difference R, means it includes only those rows of S which are not present in R. Means it includes only E is present in R and S both, so E is not included in this table. Next is intersection operation, and the intersection operation on a relation is symbolized by the R positive S. Means this is the sign of intersection operation, which includes a tuple that are only in R or only in S. For example, if you want to find out the R intersection S, means it includes only that tuples which are common in both of them. It means A and D, which are common in both of the relation, are represented by the intersection operation. Next is Cartesian product. It creates a relation that has all the attributes of R and S, and it allows all the attainable combination of tuples from R and S in the result. Means A1 is multiplied by this A1, which is written as follows. Then A1 will be multiplied by C2, A1 will be multiplied by D3, and A1 E4. Similarly, B2 A1, B2 C2, B2 D2, and B2 E4. In this way, the Cartesian product can be found out very easily by using the Cartesian product method. Next is join. Join operation is denoted by this symbol and is used to compound similar types from two relations into longer tuples. And join operation generally the cross product of two relations. For example, the notation R join, then join condition S, then it joins the condition, or it joins the two tables, that is R and S, on the particular join condition specified here. Now there are two types of join, that is natural join or outer join. Natural join means the join involves an equality test and thus often describes as an equi-join. But in equi-join, if there are duplicate records, then these records are repeated. But in natural join, if we want to eliminate the duplicacy, then we can use the natural join.
An outer join can be categorized into three categories, that is left outer, right outer and full outer join. Left outer means it keeps the data from the left hand table. Right outer means it keeps the data from the right hand corner or from the right hand table. And full outer means we keeps the data from both the tables. Here there are two tables, R and S. If we perform R left outer join, it means it will contain the data of left table and if you want to perform the right outer and if you give a command like R right outer join, then it will results this output. And in full outer join, all the records are included from both the tables. This is the relational algebra functions, that is union, intersection, and after union intersection, Cartesian product and outer join, that is left outer, outer right outer and full outer joins. Next topic is ER diagrams. Now what is the use of ER diagram, or what is ER diagram? Is entity relationship diagram in which the relationship between entities are described with the help of or are described by the graphical symbols in ER diagram, that is entity relationship diagram. And it is proposed in 1976 by Peter Chin, and it is widely used in database design to represent the conceptual level of database and describe the things and the relationship in the high level. Next is basic concepts in the ER diagram. First of all, you must have the knowledge about the entities. Entity means any object which have some attributes, which have some characteristics and behavior. Entity set means abstraction of similar things. For example, cars, students, these are the abstraction of similar things. And entity set can contain many entities. Next is attribute. Attribute means the properties of the entities of the entity set. For example, if student is entity, then the properties of student can be student name, student roll number, student course, student class, and so on. Then relationship specifies the association between two or more entities. The association between two or more entities can be known as relationship. You can see the example of ER diagram. Here there are two entities. First is customer and second is loan. The entities are represented in rectangular box. Here there are two entities, that is loan and customer. Now the customer can have attribute like customer ID, customer name, customer street, customer city. And similarly, loan can have attribute like amount, loan number. And the relationship can be described with the help of diamond box, that customer, borrower, loan. Next is relationship. It can be thought of as an association between different components. For example, the entity set M, that is Mike, Jake, Tom, and entity set F, Mary, Kate. The relationship set married between M and F will be Mike, Mary, Tom, Kate, etc.
Here the relationship is represented by a mathematical relation among m, n greater than two elements or two entities. Now it is a relation. There are different types of relations or different types of association between two or more than two entities. For example, one to one, one to many, many to one, and many to many. For example, if we talk about the first record, it has one to one relationship with first record. Then second, it has many to many relationship, or you can say one to many. This is one to many, this is many to one. Many to one. Similarly, there is one to one relationship between different entities. You can see here one to many relation, one to many relation, again one to one relation, one to many relation, one to one, and again one to one. Similarly, one to one relation, one to one, one to one, one to many, one to many, and again one to many. Now, how we can calculate the degree of relationship? The degree of relationship can be calculated or the number by the number of entity sets that participate in the particular relation. And the cardinality can be one to one. For example, the association between a particular type of automobile with a particular type of engine. The association between engine and automobile is one to one. One to many means student can enroll in many courses. Then one to many. Many to one means subordinates and supervisor, or subordinates and superior, or employees and director. The many to one and many to many means courses and student. One student's can take admission in more than one courses, and in one course there can be many students. This is one to one and one to many relationship in a graphical form. A1 is associated with B1, A2 is associated with B2, A3 is associated with B3, similarly A4 is associated with B4. And in second one, A1 is associated with B1 and B2, A2 is associated with B3 and B4, and A3 is associated with B5 only. Next is many to one. You can see the many to one relation, that is A1 and A2 both are associated with B1. Similarly, A3 is associated with B2, and A4 and A5 are associated with the B3. This is many to one. And if we talk about many to many, then A1 is associated with B2, and A1 is also associated with B1. Similarly, A2 is associated with B1. A3 is associated with B3, and it is also associated with B4, and A4 is associated with B3. This is many to many relation. Here you can see one to many relation, customer, borrower, loan. If we talk about many to one, then customer, borrower, loan. Many to many relationship can also exist there. Alternative cardinality specification means you can specify the cardinality by particular representation method, particular specification method, like 0 to many and 1 to 1. Next is total participation. What is the meaning of total participation? When we require an entity to participate in a relation, then we use double lines to specify that particular entity. In this, every loan have to have at least one customer. So there is a total participation. We use double lines to specify the total participation of a particular entity in a relationship. Next is self-relationship. Sometimes entities in the entity set, may relate to the other entities of the same set, and thus it is self-relationship. For example, in this diagram here, the employees manage some other employees. Then the label manager and worker are called roles of the self-relationship because the employee manages some other employees. Some more example of self-relationship are parent and children, manager and employee, husband, wife, and word to word is root and synonym. Now, what is attribute? Attribute means through which we can identify a particular entity, or we can say with the help of attribute we can identify we can define a particular type of entity. Each entity has some set of attributes. The attribute may be composite attribute, may be multi-valued attribute, and may be derived attribute. And to present these type of attributes are defined in different terms. Now, what is composite attribute? Composite attribute is which is a collection of more than one value. For example, if we talk about name, name is a combination of first name and last name, then it is composite attribute. If we talk about multi-valued attribute, then multi-valued attribute is represented in double ellipse, and multi-valued attribute means an attribute which can have more than one value. For example, if we talk about contact number, any person can have more than one contact number. Similarly, if we talk about skills as an attribute, then every person has more than one skills, then this is multi-valued attribute. And derived attribute means the attribute which derives its values from the other attribute. For example, on the basis of basic salary, DA and HRA is calculated, all the allowances are calculated on the basis of basic salary. So these allowances are derived attribute because they derive the value from the basic salary attribute. Here is an example of ER diagram that customer is an entity. Customer have phone number, date of birth, age. Age is derived attribute. Then customer ID. Then address. Address can be city, state and zip code. Street. Street can be street name, street number, apartment. Customer name can be first name and last name and middle initial. Now we have already talked about the primary key and candidate keys. What are the candidate key which can serve as primary key, and what are the primary keys which are the unique identifier or on the basis of which you can uniquely identify the different entities. Here, author, name, birthday, description, death. Name, birthday, description, death are the attributes of entity name author. Next is ternary relationship. Ternary means when a relationship or when three entities are participated in a relationship. For example, employee works on branch or job, employee works on job and employee works on branch. This is a example of ternary relationship. Employee have employee ID, employee name, street and city. Similarly, branch have branch name, branch city and assets, and job have title and level. All the primary keys are underlined with a particular line to identify the primary key of each entity. The primary key is underlined in this way. For example, in branch, branch name is primary key, in job, title is primary key, and in employee, employee ID is primary key. Now, design the ER diagram. If we have to design a database for an old online reservation system for microscope in material sciences lab, then there are two types of users.
First is microscope administrator and microscope end users. And each microscope is located in specific lab, and each request is assigned to our administrator, who can authorize or deny the request. You using of some of the microscope requires a present of an administrator, and time is divided into 1 hour slots. Each reservation can only take one or more time slots. Means while designing any ER diagram, we must notice some of the things. Like while designing an ER diagram, firstly we have to specify the entities included in a particular entity relationship diagram. Firstly we have to identify the entities, then we have to find out the attributes of that particular entity through which we can identify that particular entity. And after identifying the attributes of the entities, next step is to relate different entities by using the relationship or by setting the association between two or more entities. Next is weak entity set. Now what is weak entity? Weak entity means the existence of which depends on the other entity is known as weak entity. Means any entity whose existence depends on the existence of another entity is known as weak entity. For example, if we talk about Marx, or if we take Marx as an entity, then if there exists any student, only then the Marx can exist. So Marx is a weak entity whose existence depends on the existence of the student entity. And to denote the weak entity, double rectangle is used. And to represent the weak entity relationship, double diamond is used and dashed underscore for discriminator is used. Next, some of the notations that are used in entity sets are: first is rectangle to represent an entity set, circle is used to represent the attribute, then double rectangle is used to represent the weak entity set, and double circle is used to present the multi-valued attribute. Similarly, if we want to show the relationship set, then diamond box is used, double diamond box is used to identify the relationship set for weak entity set. Then the circle in oval, if we want to present any attribute, then we use simple circle, and the primary key is underlined. Derived attribute is represented by dashed circle. And if we represent total participation of entity set, then double lines are used. And for discriminating attribute of weak entity set, dashed line is used. Now there are different notations for relationship. Many to many relationship is shown in this way. Many to one relationship, one to one relationship, cardinality, limits from one to a particular limit is a relationship. That is specialization and generalization. Total generalization is shown in this diagram, and this is for role indicator to define the role of a particular person. Then this is a question for the ER diagram for the online music store, and the database will contain some concepts like songs, artists, bands, albums, genres, and you have to state the ER diagram to represent the online music store which contain these attributes or these entities. Firstly, you have to identify the entities, then you have to mention the attributes of different entities, then you have to relate these entities in different ways. This is all about the ER diagrams. You can see an ER diagram of employee management system, in which employee is an entity which have some characteristics like gender, salary, address, name. Name can be first name, last name, employee, supervision, employee supervise, and it can be supervisor, and then employee manage department, or you can say department manage employee. Department has name, department has number, and department has locations. One department has multiple locations, so this is shown in multi-valued attribute. Then department controls project, and employee works on project. His total participation, so it is shown by using double lines. Employee dependent depends on employee. Dependent is a weak entity, so it is represented by double rectangle box. Dependent depends of employee, and dependent have some attributes like name, gender, birth date, and relationship. This is the ER diagram of employee, department, project, and dependent, in which multi-valued attributes are displayed, primary keys are displayed, total dependency cardinalities are shown.